Welcome everybody to this presentation of the Matrix Reloaded, Multiplication Strategies in Photochem. My name is Joppe Bos and this is joint work with Maximilian Offner, Joost Rennes, Tobias Schneider and Christine van Vredendaal, all at NXP Semiconductors, and his work was done while Maximilian was an internship student. So as you're probably well aware, there is this ongoing threat of quantum computers against cryptography in general, and most notably against public key cryptography. Because of Shor's algorithm, this has a massive impact on RSA and elliptic curve cryptography. And of course, starting in 2016, government organizations like NIST are looking into ways how to migrate to new cryptographic standards. Often when we discuss this with colleagues or with our customers, it's clear that you can get into lengthy discussions when we think that a sufficiently powerful quantum computer will be available to pose a real threat. Yeah, we honestly believe that this should not be the main focus of discussion. The main focus is not when does a quantum computer become available, but when does become this new standard available? Because of course, when this new public key post-quantum secure standard is there, then people expect that this is available and can be used in practice. So this is a much more important timeline. And yeah, the current view on this NIST new standard is that this post-quantum crypto standard will be available within 2.5 years from now. So we don't know yet which scheme or schemes will be the new public key standard. What we do know is the overview you see on this slide. So NIST has announced their round 3 in July 2020, and there are several candidates for key encapsulation mechanisms, so key exchange, and several candidates for digital signatures. On the left-hand side, you see the finalist schemes, so 4 for key exchange, Kyber, Sabre, Andrew, and Classic McAleese, and 3 for digital signatures, the Lithium, Rainbow, and Falcon. And on the right-hand side, you see the alternate schemes, and you can think of these as some sort of a backup schemes in case something happens with one of the main schemes or schemes which in the future might get standardized as well. And from this second category, and then for key encapsulation, is exactly one of the schemes we will focus on in this presentation, which is Photochem. So what is Photochem exactly? So here on the top right-hand side, you will see a screenshot from the specification and the authors who submitted Photochem to the NIST standardization effort. So Photochem is a key exchange protocol based on the learning with errors problem and that framework. It importantly relies on the hardness of problems in generic lattices, meaning that a lot of the optimizations in terms of performance, but also in terms of size, applied to other schemes are not present. So the ring-based versions of the LWE problem or the module-based versions. So this is a generic version, which in turn works in generic lattices. So this has a negative impact on the size and performance, but it in turn has a positive impact on the perceived security of these schemes, because it naturally translates into problems in generic lattices. Yeah, and one of the upsides, of course, of this LWE proposal is that it is one of the alternate schemes in round 3, as you just saw on the previous slide. And so we looked at the scheme, and one of the main bottlenecks, of course, here is that instead of working in a polynomial ring, like for the module and the ring-based versions, you now work with matrices. And the question and the main operation is not multiplication with polynomials, but really matrix vector or matrix matrix multiplications. And This, of course, leads to a significant performance impact, and the question is, can we do any better in terms of this matrix multiplication? Can we use faster algorithms or different algorithms which are asymptotically better than what is used now? And if not, are there situations possible where these faster algorithms can be used? And this was all motivated by a paper from 2016 by Wang, Schmidt, Henry, and Van de Geijn, Strassen's algorithm reloaded, where they actually showed that if you go for asymptotically better matrix multiplication algorithm, like Strassen multiplication, the threshold point where it pays off to actually switch from schoolbook to Strassen already occurs for much lower dimensions, matrices, than people often think. And we decided to look into this, of course, from a cryptographic point of view with Frodochem in mind. So maybe let's start from the beginning. So matrix multiplication. So in Frodochem, the multiplication or one of the matrix multiplications is where you multiply a small matrix S prime with a large matrix A, and then you add in an error matrix. So there, so B prime, S prime, and E prime are of dimensions n bar times n, where n bar is always 8 in Frodochem, and n is some larger number in the order of magnitude of several hundred, and I will show the exact parameters in a couple slides. And A is this big matrix where you, it's a square matrix n times n, where n was this larger number. So if one uses a schoolbook multiplication for this matrix multiplication, then it works as shown on this slide, and you can see a graphical representation here on the right. And this, of course, has complexity n bar times n squared. But even when you use schoolbook, there are many practical optimizations one can do to get constant factor speedups. And think especially about ways how you access your memory within your matrices, because that leads to much better cache behavior and much quicker loading times of your elements. So when we look at this slightly differently, another way to implement schoolbook, which will give us a nice introduction, and then we move towards Strassen, is to split your matrix big matrices into four equally sized submatrices, as shown on this slide. And once you've done this, of course, you can do schoolbook based on these smaller matrices, as shown on the bottom left here. And then, of course, this can be done with 8 products of half the dimensions. And this is just schoolbook, of course. And now one way to optimize this, which is now known as Strassen multiplication, is shown here. So here, instead of 8 products of this dimension, you only need to compute 7 of these products, denoted by m0 till m6. And then, but of course, there is an increase in the number of matrix additions and matrix subtractions you need to compute. But if we only look at the number of multiplications, then now, instead of n to the power 3, this goes down to, when you do this recursively, to n to the power 2.807. And of course, Strassen multiplication is only the start of a range of optimizations, and not the end. When you look at a range of work, and I omitted a lot of other work, but you can see there's schoolbook, Strassen, then there are other famous matrix multiplication algorithms like Coppersmith, Winograd, where the exponent is 2.375. And then the latest in this range of optimizations is the work by Allman and Williams, which is 2.3728 in the exponent. It is generally well understood that these later works, the asymptotics only kick in for very, very large dimensions, much larger than what we consider in crypto. And the big question, of course, is, does it make sense to switch from schoolbook to Strassen for the dimensions we consider in cryptography? So yeah, so that were the two questions we set out to answer. So first of all, is the way how the matrix multiplication is implemented in the reference and optimized implementation of RhodoCAM the best way of doing it, or can we get a constant time speed up by accessing the memory in a different way? And then the follow-up question was, does it pay off to actually switch to Strasse matrix multiplication, or is Yeah, schoolbook simply better for the dimensions we use in practice. So what are these dimensions we use in practice? So these matrices are integer matrices, modulo Q, where Q, depending on your parameter set, is 2 to the 15 or 2 to the 16, so they're always powers of 2. And the smaller matrices are of size n bar times n, where n bar is always 8, and n is either 640, 976 or 1344. So large matrices to store, but in terms of in other fields, for instance, in computer science, where they work with much, much larger matrices, of course, where these asymptotically fast algorithms immediately kick in. And the question is, yeah, does it make sense or does it pay off to use Strasse for the dimensions mentioned here? Then it's not simply only matrix multiplication or matrix multiplication where n adding in an error term, but these matrices are typically generated on the fly with either AES or with shake, depending which again which parameter set you use, and yeah, for ease of explanation, I will focus on AES throughout this slide deck. So how does that work? So you set a matrix, and depending on the position where you are in your matrix, you put in some numbers depending on the row and the column, so the I and the j. And you pad the rest with zeros, and then you use this as input together with a seed, which is used as a key into AES, and then the output is your public big matrix A, which is used for your arithmetic. And hence, when you do this, of course, when you work with 8 columns at a time, you get something, as you can see at the bottom of the slide here, for your different rows. And then the IDE, which is already used in the optimized RhodoCAM implementation, is to, because you need to access these elements in a different order, and to make sure that when you access them, they're next to each other in memory. You first transpose, or you first generate a subpart of A, you transpose this, and then you use this transposed submatrix in your matrix multiplication algorithm, because then the access to this matrix is much, much faster. So graphically, this looks as follows. So here on the left-hand side, we have our matrix S prime, which is n bar is 8 times n, and then you work on that in chunks of 8 at a time, and then on the or you loop over that over the entire length, I mean. And then on the other hand, we have our large matrix A, which is of dimensions n times n, and then we work on that with 8 rows at a time. And here you can see that indeed you generate these subparts. You first generate these different rows, 8 columns at a time, and then you would transpose this in order to multiply with S prime to have them nicely aligned and in order in memory how you want them. This is the additional advantage that then you can also make use of these faster SIMD instructions, so single instruction multiple data paradigm like AVX or AVX2. Where particularly with these AVX2 instructions, you can do a 16-way, 16-bit operations in parallel, which of course gives you another constant time speed up. So if we now look at different approaches, because matrix multiplication, of course, is a very well-studied field, and there are many, many different techniques people have already looked into. How to do this particularly efficient in implementations in practice. And one of these approaches, so we experimented with multiple, was this blocking and packing approach, which is part of this Bliss framework. And you can see the two references here, where this is described in detail. And we used this approach, but then brought it to the crypto setting because we also had to look how to generate the things on the fly. And this is what we call the row-wise cache-friendly matrix multiplication algorithm, because we now the goal is to generate the matrix A row-wise in a cache-friendly way based on this blocking and packing approach. So how does this work? So that the generic motivation of this was that we, although very efficient, much efficient than doing things naively, you still have to do this transpose. And this transpose of all of these submatrices is relatively slow. Is there a way that we can avoid this transposition? So, and the answer is yes, by using this approach. And then the question is this actually any faster in practice? So now the idea is to generate your matrix A not per columns but per rows, avoiding this transposition. And then you would initialize your resulting matrix as the error, and then you accumulate the rest in a memory-friendly manner as shown here. And now the pattern, you can see the pattern here overlaying how you actually access your matrix elements in black. So in gray you would see the old approach, the original approach, and in black on top of this you would see this RWCF approach. So now we zigzag through the matrix S prime, but we go, as you can see here, in order without the need to transpose A over the rows in A. And again, this, similar to the previous approach, has the same advantage that we can use SIMD instructions like AVX2, and running many of these things in parallel. So, how does this look in practice? So we implemented this Kuboek-based multiplication and the Strasse matrix multiplication, one recursion level, so only one level of Strasse. And we benchmarked on an AMD machine how this looks. So here in the table you can see the benchmark results in thousands of cycles, which are an average. So the first, the x64 numbers, are numbers from the optimized implementation, which was part of the submission package of RodoChem. The Strasse figures are when using matrix multiplication using the Strasse approach, and RWCF is the approach based on the blocking and packing I just shown on the previous slide. In brackets, you can see the relative performance compared to the x64 approach. So if it is higher than one, then it's actually slower. If it's lower than one, it means that the runtime is actually faster than the x64 approach. If you look at the couple of columns, so there you see the multiplication of A times S plus E, or S prime times A plus E. And if there is this in brackets pre, it means that it's without the generation of the matrix elements using AES, which of course is the other big bottleneck in RodoChem. So on the one hand, you have the generation of the matrix elements using a symmetric algorithm, and on the other hand, you have the arithmetic itself, so working and multiplication of these matrices. So here, it immediately becomes clear. So if you look at multiplication and do not consider the generation of AES, you can actually see that, interestingly, the Strasse approach is faster than the implementation provided by the authors in RodoChem. So that is already a very interesting observation. That this asymptotically faster algorithm pays off to use. However, it turns out if we go to this other Schoolbook algorithm, which accesses or avoids this transposition of the submatrices, it's actually even faster. And then you can see that you're almost twice as fast when you do not consider the generation of the matrix A using AES. If you do consider this, so that is the second marked numbers on this slide, you can actually see that you still get a speed up because the runtime is 0.71. And of course, the big question is, how does this impact Frodo-Chem overall? So in the encapsulation or the decapsulation, and that are in the last two rows. And there you can see that overall, by using Schoolbook and this RWCF approach, you get 1.24 roughly times faster. So that is already a really significant and nice speed up, of course, in practice. But then, of course, the big question is, at what point? So we know at some point it will start to make sense to switch from Schoolbook to Strasse. But when is this threshold? And does it is that even interesting for cryptographic purposes? So on this last question, the answer might be yes, because also for RSA and for ECC, and but also for symmetric key crypto, people have looked into batching. So what is batching? Batching is the setting where you want to compute many cryptographic operations at the same time, so a batch of these operations. And then the idea is that by processing a batch of these operations, you can increase the throughput, so the number of cryptographic operations you do per second, of course, at the cost of some latency. So it might take a little bit longer for the results to be available, but then the server typically can actually compute much more crypto operations per second and is much more efficient. So does this make sense for Frodo-Chem? And the answer is it might be, depends on your use case, of course. But if you do a batch decapsulation where the same public matrix A is used, because recall, this large matrix A might be the same over different operations. And then when you get many different S primes, smaller matrices, which you need to multiply by this large matrix A, you can actually try to consider multiple of these matrices S at once, and you stitch them together. And then you get not a matrix S of dimensions N bar times N, but K times N bar times N, where you do K batches at the same time. And now the question is, of course, does it make sense for some value of k to actually switch over from a Schoolbook-based matrix multiplication algorithm to a Strasse multiplication-based algorithm? So we try to run this, and the paper has obviously much more details for the middle parameter set. And here you can see on the y-axis the millions of cycles for the three different approaches. And then it becomes already clear that only for k equals 19, Strasse starts to outperform our better Schoolbook-based matrix multiplication algorithm. And then, of course, since this is asymptotically better, the gap only widens. So it will get faster and faster for the more and the more batches you compute. So there the answer is that yes, even for relatively small amount of batches, so already if you work with 19 batches, but in practice, of course, you typically want to work with a power of two, then it starts to make a lot of sense to actually switch from the matrix-based or Schoolbook-based matrix multiplication to an asymptotically faster one like Strasse. So to conclude, yes, it makes a lot of sense to switch matrix multiplication strategies in practice in Frodo-Chem. So what we found is that by using a different way to access the memory within your matrix, or how to load these elements into memory, has a significant impact on the practical performance. So this row-wise cache-friendly scheme we implemented makes the matrix multiplication almost twice as fast if you do not consider the generation time of the matrix, and it and roughly 1.4 times faster, including the AES generation. This is still Scoopbook based, so it's the what we found is that the fastest approach still uses a Scoopbook based multiplication approach. Asymptotically faster algorithms start to outperform this only when you consider batches of size 19 or larger, so still relatively small, but still multiple batches at the same time. And this shows that in schemes where performance is one of the main bottlenecks, for instance in Frodo-Chem, that by switching to these algorithms, you get overall for your ncaps and decapsulation a factor of roughly 1.24 times speed up in practice, which of course is a very decent result. All these approaches have been implemented and integrated in the official Frodo-Chem implementation, which you can find on GitHub. If there are any questions, don't hesitate to contact us or leave any feedback in the chat. Thank you very much.